Lance. No dogs allowed on the second floor at all. No playing of my records. No sniffing of crotches. No drinking out of the toilet. You will not beg for food. No ball playing in the house. No chewing or slobbering of my shoes. You will not hide from me. This is not your room.
Maybe I will.
Will what?
Rob Lowe stars in Youngblood, Christmas night at 10.
We catch up with today's news when we join ITN in a few minutes.
I want evidence. I want corroboration. I want to solve this case.
Prime Suspect 2, Tuesday and Wednesday at 9 on HTV.
Merry Christmas from Anchor.
Walt Disney's classic Cinderella is only available on video for a limited time, so hurry before the spell's broken. Bring home Walt Disney's classic Cinderella.
Good sir.
Where are you?
L'esprit exotique. L'esprit défendu.
C'est bon, ça. C'est du vaudou?
Non, 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 cher. C'est tabou.
Ça va le faire mémé?
Ah non, cher. L'homme l'a fou-fou quand même.
Salut! Salut!
Who'd have thought? An advert shot in aromavision. Oh, he can actually smell the rice coming off the TV. Mmm, this one's garlic. What, you can't smell it? Well, put your face up against the screen. Oops. There, you see? Garlic, right under your nose. Only a whiff, I admit. Well, it is called Batchelor's delicately flavoured rice, after all. Oh, look, a whole range of aromas.
Where can you find permanently low prices on all sorts of toys? And Christmas crackers? On all your drink? On fruit and nuts? And all kinds of chocolates? At Asda, where prices are constantly checked to keep them low. That Asda price.
At last, here is the ultimate country collection. 40 all-time greats from country's Hall of Fame. From the heart of the Midwest, today's songs of love and heartache. Tammy Wynette, Willie Nelson. From Johnny Cash to the new country of Nancy Griffith, here's the one album that has it all. The Ultimate Country Collection.
Oh, love is blind.
It includes Jim Reeves, Waylon Jennings, Kris Kristofferson, George Jones, Crystal Gayle, and Don Williams.
I recall a gypsy woman, silver spangles.
The very best, with Glen Campbell, Patsy Cline.
You walk by and I fall to pieces.
Here is the ultimate collection of all that's great about country music.
The discomfort, the misery, the burn of acid indigestion. Rennie works fast. In fact, more people in Britain take Rennie than any other indigestion remedy. For fast, effective relief of indigestion and heartburn, take Rennie.
No, it's absolutely pure, so you have to treat it with respect. I never drink it on the first night.
It'll be a perfect Christmas this year on ITV. But make sure you've sent your Christmas cards. Mr. Bean's doing his now.
Where is my present?
It's in your room.
I don't know what to say. I'm overwhelmed.
Oh, it's nothing.
Maybe not to you. Maybe to me. It's a lot to me.
Where?
Christmas dinner. The Queen at 3.
Has she come?
We've done the same for years now. It's a sort of ritual, I suppose. Always swap presents about 4. Then at 5, my cousin always rings. Auntie Peggy's son. Then we all gather around the phone, each have a little chat with him.
Where is he, Australia?
No, Blackpool.
Christmas wouldn't be Christmas without the best in entertainment. And who better than Michael Barrymore to take the audience in hand?
All we want you to do, my love, if we're missing one from sitting on top of the tree, get your legs up.
Christmas and children go together, and that's why our Christmas blind date is especially for the kids.
Well, hi, Robert.
Hiya.
Hello, this is the Queen here.
Excuse me, Your Majesty. Your Highness. The Queen asked if you could get some Gordon's gin. Some corn cake of crisps.
Matthew Kelly hosts a special Christmas edition of You Bet in the studio with the band of the Royal Marines and below decks with a You Bet challenge against the clock.
Fire going
And there's a brand new Christmas special from the Darling Buds of May as Ma and Pa set off for a winter break on the continent.
France.
Yeah, well, Paris, France, they think. Not just because of l'amour and la manger, but they've got a place there called Cognac. Now, any country that can name a town after a drink can't be all bad. That's what I reckon, anyway.
Every night's a movie night this Christmas on ITV. Clint Eastwood's a preacher with a cracking delivery.
Man, there's nothing like a nice piece of hickory.
I'm between jobs.
Everybody! Hands up! Hands up! Stick them up! This is a holdup! I said stick them up!
Okay, Lucas, I'm listening. Tell us what you want.
I don't want anything. I'm the hostage.
What's happening, Apone? Can't see anything in here.
Pull your team out, Gorman.
I got signals. I got readings in front and behind.
Where, man?
Look, I'm telling you, there's something moving and it ain't us.
Hey. Queen, eh? Yeah. Queen, God bless her. Only one thing wrong with Her Majesty, though.
What's that
then? She's a big prisoner. Now, come on, Jim. Where could you find better to spend Christmas than this, eh? I mean, look at it, eh? The sun, the sea, blue sky, and all the rest of it.
I'll tell you, Bruce. London. Snow and ice and fog and
the blues. You've no idea who I am, have you?
Yes. You're Sado Noopsy. Look, I don't care who you are. I do care that you kidnapped a little kid, though.
I could destroy you just like that.
Top movies, top entertainment, all here for you to enjoy a perfect Christmas on ITV.
Friday in Gone to Seed, Hilda's on the verge of imprisonment.
I promise I'll never shoot you again.
I know why you're here. It's about the pornography, isn't it?
It happens the world over. Crank caramel, crime passionnel.
Could this be the end of the line for Hilda? Find out in Gone to Seed, Friday at 8 on HTV.
From the headquarters of ITN, News at 10, with Trevor MacDonald.
Yeltsin and his reform program suffer a devastating blow. Ashdown comes under mortar attack in Bosnia. Perth prison siege ends, a hostage is released unharmed. And discarded in the dustbin, how Britain gained its first world heavyweight title for almost a century. Good evening. The entire future of economic reform in Russia hangs in the balance tonight after President Boris Yeltsin suffered a crushing defeat in the Russian parliament. For many weeks, and especially during the Congress, which ended today, Mr. Yeltsin had fought to keep his reformist Prime Minister Yegor Gaidar. Today, he gave up that fight, and with it, almost certainly, his dream of accelerating the pace of economic reform. The man with whom Mr. Yeltsin must now do business is already hinting at a return to some centralized planning. Here's our Moscow correspondent, James Mates.
Communist supporters jubilant near Red Square this evening. For 2 weeks, hardliners have been locked in combat with President Yeltsin. Tonight, it was the president who blinked. Just 4 days ago, he was threatening a national referendum because Yegor Gaidar was rejected as prime minister by Russia's conservative parliament. He then won a deal which would have allowed him to keep the architect of his reforms as at least his acting prime minister. But he ducked the challenge, instead handing the most powerful job in his cabinet to Viktor Chernomyrdin, a little-known conservative who was once a minister under communism. The new man said he was for reform, but on his own terms.
I am for reform, but not through the impoverishment of the people.
Hardliners applauded, but the reformers were devastated. Gaidar immediately announced his resignation from the government.
Of course, I'm going to resign, and I will not be staying in the government.
It's expected several other reformist ministers will leave the cabinet as well. Yeltsin's spokesman tried to explain the dumping of Gaida as a tactical retreat.
So not to endanger the social order, certainly he was obliged to make some maneuvers.
Did he lose his nerve?
No.
A robust denial, but the impression here is that Yeltsin has abandoned the reformers. And impressions count, particularly in the West, where potential investors will not be encouraged by what's happened today. Russia is desperate for investment to modernize areas like its oil industry, but Western firms have stayed on the sidelines to see which way the wind is blowing. They will now remain skeptical. There must be doubt, too, about the future of the privatization program. Everyone's been given vouchers to invest in Russian shops or factories. But with the reformers gone, will hardline ministers ever expose wasteful, heavy industry to market forces? It's more likely they'll want to continue giving subsidies, the same subsidies that are swallowing up the budget and fueling inflation. The difference now is that increasingly, Chernomyrdin and his new ministers will take these decisions rather than a weakened President Yeltsin. James Mates, News at 10, Moscow.
For an assessment of the damage to Mr. Yeltsin, James Mates joins me now from Moscow. James Mates, we've been down this road before, but are we talking tonight about the death knell for Russian economic reform?
Well, the men who've taken over here are no friends of reform. They've fought a guerrilla campaign against the Gaida reforms for the last few months, and now they're in charge. That does not necessarily mean they're going to start winding back, start going back to the days of complete state control of the economy. But on the other hand, they're not going to move forward with any degree of enthusiasm down the roads of privatization or allowing the market to work.
Mr. Yeltsin's path has been strewn with difficulties, and he's got out of them before. Can he again?
Just last Thursday, President Yeltsin was accusing the Conservatives in Congress of trying to recreate the coup of August 1991. It was a creeping coup going on, he said. But now he's made one of them his prime minister. His natural allies, the people who've stuck with him since the coup, right through these last few months, are beside themselves this evening. Devastated, one of them said to me when I asked him what he thought about it. They feel completely betrayed. And of course, the new men who are taking over are not friends of Yeltsin and will not become them now. He's in a very difficult and much, much weaker position.
James Mates, thank you. The debate over the possible use of military force in Bosnia-Herzegovina is again gaining momentum and could soon come to a head. America and France want a resolution to allow the UN to enforce a no-fly zone. But it's thought Mr. Major will urge President Bush to resist pressure to increase military activity. In Bosnia itself, a convoy carrying the Liberal Democrat leader Paddy Ashdown came under mortar fire today. ITN's Robert Moore is there.
Paddy Ashdown has long argued the West is doing too little, too late for Bosnia. Through gun sights, he surveyed the countryside where this conflict is showing no signs of abating. The British Army escorted him along one of the most dangerous stretches of road, where a BBC cameraman was recently killed, where machine gun fire, mortars and artillery shelling has become a daily event. They were leaving Turbay, a besieged frontline Muslim town, when the mortar hit. A muffled explosion, a cloud of earth to the left of the road, a few meters from Ashdown's vehicle. It was a narrow escape, though one the British Army would regard as a regular hazard. To the sound of gunfire, Paddy Ashdown went in to talk and listen to local Bosnian commanders.
Yes, bitter fighting continues.
Mr. Ashdown says the conflict may be complex, but the question is simple.
Are we prepared to allow the Muslim community in Bosnia-Herzegovina to be wiped out? If we are, that will mean that we're prepared to tolerate terrible slaughter. But much more importantly, we are prepared to risk the spread of this conflict with incalculable consequences right throughout the Balkans.
The nearby town of Travnik is also being shelled. Dozens of such Muslim communities are under siege this winter, an almost medieval war. But one, as Ashdown nearly discovered to his cost today, fought with the most modern of weapons. The question stays the same. Can the UN remain spectators, or will they be forced to do more than escort politicians and humanitarian aid? Robert Moore, News at 10, Bosnia.
Earlier this year, ITN exposed the appalling conditions inside Serb-run prisoner of war camps in Bosnia. Today, the International Red Cross supervised the release of some of the men held in one of those camps. Penny Marshall, who first revealed the prisoners' plight, was there to see them go free.
Roll call at Banyatcha, but this time the guards were calling freedom. 1,000 men were released after 4 months of political wrangling. They've left at least 2,000 behind them. It's hoped they'll follow soon, leaving this pitiful camp empty and for good. Two other camps have now closed completely. Since ITN's cameras exposed Banyatcha in August, the International Red Cross has done much to improve conditions. But this prisoner release was only secured last week in Geneva. The awful chapter of civilian suffering in large-scale detention camps in this area, at least, seems now to be nearing an end. Dusk on the Croatian border, and the men were finally ferried out of Bosnia. The UN watching, the press waiting, the Bosnian Serbs relenting.
That it would be a very heavy burden for them if these prisoners started to die, and they have made a lot of efforts with the help of the ICRC to improve the conditions of detention, but nor them nor us can stop the winter.
These Muslim men are now heading for the West, for Norway, Italy and Spain. They've been dressed and fed by Western charity, a small success in this bloody civil war, outside help replacing inter-ethnic cruelty.
Cynics may say that this is a sop, just a carefully stage-managed effort by the Serbs to silence their critics. But if it is, it's one that saved more than 1,000 lives.
And it's hoped 2,000 more will be saved this week as Banyatcha finally closes. Penny Marshall, News at 10, on the Bosnian-Croatian border.
A bullish John Major declared the Edinburgh summit a great achievement today, but opposition MPs and Tory rebels weren't that impressed. The Prime Minister told the Commons that many of the so-called insoluble problems of Europe had been solved. And he said the community now had a common purpose. But the Labour leader, John Smith, said the issue most relevant to people of the community, jobs, had been ignored. Our political correspondent Mark Webster reports.
After weeks of being sniped at, John Major's success in Edinburgh has done much to restore his authority within the party and abroad. And in the process, he's further isolated the hardy band of Eurosceptics still fighting a rearguard action against the Maastricht Bill.
I believe the majority of people in this country want us to make a success of our membership of the European community. That is not a matter just of idealism, it is a matter of hard-hearted self-national interest.
Though the opposition welcomed some of the outcome from Edinburgh, Labour said he'd signally failed to tackle one vital issue.
How many jobs does the Prime Minister calculate will be created in the United Kingdom? And given the appalling prospect of sharply rising unemployment, why was there no proposal for an emergency employment programme right across the whole community?
Well, Madam Speaker, with great goodwill, I have to say that was a very mealy-mouthed and nitpicking response. All the way across Europe today, the heads of the government that deal with us have praised the outcome of this summit. Not a single word of retraction from the Right Honourable Gentleman.
And though they may be weary, the Euro dissidents certainly haven't given up yet. However, their influence appears to be waning in the Commons and the Lords.
Sometimes successes can be failures, and the Edinburgh success, undoubted success, is a failure for Britain and it's a failure for Europe, because eventually it will collapse in tears, and the longer it takes to collapse in tears, the worse it will be.
But John Major has argued that Edinburgh has put the Maastricht process back on track. Question is, will it be a smooth journey? In the new year, the Danes take over the EC presidency, and all eyes will be on them as they try to persuade their own people to accept the Edinburgh deal. On January the 11th, Parliament returns to continue the drawn-out process of debating Maastricht, with 300 amendments that will take several months. Meanwhile, the Danes have said they'll hold their crucial second referendum in April or May. If Mr. Major wants to stay on track, he'll want the treaty ratified here after the Danish referendum, but before the end of this parliamentary session. And with his standing much enhanced by the summit, Mr. Major looks set to get his way. Provided, that is, the Danes do vote yes in their second referendum, and the Labour Party abstains on the third reading of the bill. Maastricht looks set to become law in this country by July of next year. Mark Webster, News at 10, Westminster.
The prison officer who was taken hostage at Perth prison on Tayside yesterday was released unharmed late this afternoon. The officer had been held for more than 24 hours by a group of prisoners who had barricaded themselves into D Hall. They were protesting at the recording of relatives' visits by video cameras. Our Scotland correspondent Hugh Pym has the details.
Fire engines leaving Perth jail tonight, signalling an end to the violent protest, an end to a 24-hour ordeal for a prison officer held hostage.
During the latter part of the afternoon, 13 prisoners left the hall, and shortly before 5, the remainder came out with 28-year-old prison officer Frank Hargreaves.
Earlier, while prison officers in full riot gear manoeuvred into position on the roof, negotiators, helped by the prison chaplain, worked amid the wreckage of D Hall, most of its cell windows smashed. The prisoners demanded a lawyer, the message conveyed through this sign. A Glasgow solicitor was called. The prisoners gave themselves up soon afterwards. Another banner signalled the main grievance. Leave our visits in peace, it said. The prisoners angry about tight security in visiting hours.
They don't just stand and watch you there. They've got cameras surrounding every place. And if you move, they follow the movements. So if you put your hand up to eat something, they're watching you.
All the watching during visiting hours, the use of video cameras, is because the authorities are concerned about drugs being smuggled in. But the prisoners say the crackdown has simply gone too far.
A lot of boys have been getting a pattern report, which is you get strip search after a visit, and a lot of boys have been getting accused of smuggling drugs when they haven't.
So the riot control teams were heading home tonight. It's the fifth time in as many years they've been called in to this, Scotland's oldest prison. Hugh Pym, News at 10, Perth.
Coming next on News at 10, in Somalia, disagreement over who should disarm the gunmen, while the Americans say it's not their job. The sister of Susie Lamplu survives an attempted kidnap, how she was held at knife point. And in Focus on Britain, the drug culture in Britain's jails, how inmates feed their addiction.
It's easy to get drugs in every jail. More heavy drugs now than there's ever been. And I'm talking now about